Hi, I'm Stephen Root. You're not, and this is the first time. I had always known the original show of Perry Mason from the 60s because, as I said, I'm ancient.
Amory Fallon, unaccustomed to drink, had fallen asleep. He slept for 45 minutes without knowing it. But you knew it, didn't you?
And Raymond Burr, you know, always loved him as an actor. One of our producers said, "We're going to do this Perry Mason show, but we're going to set it in the 30s before Perry Mason is a lawyer, he's an investigator, and it's going to be a period piece." And I said, "Well, that's really interesting." I said, "I'm, you know, sign me up for that." Fuchs in Barry started out as a different character. We shot the pilot with Fuchs as a really very big character, always screaming and yelling at Barry. And while it was funny, it didn't have any place to go. I mean, the network nooks for that were like, "He's great. We love this character, but you're already starting at 11. You know, where are you going to come from?" So we scrapped that footage from the pilot, reshot it during the first and second shows. We would go back and redo my parts of the pilot so that he could become the bad uncle character that you see now.
I really miss you so much.
Oh, okay.
Get in here.
You don't think I'll fucking miss you? My boy. Yeah. I gotcha.
So that he started, "Pal, you're my buddy, you're my pal, you need to do this for me. Yeah, please do this for me. Do this for me!
Help me!"
I did some extra work on One Life to Live, and that led to my first TV appearance in about, I don't know, 85, 86, something like that, doing a mental patient on One Life to Live. And from that, I got an audition for George Romero's Monkey Shines.
"I don't want to fire you, Jeffrey. I just want to get you to produce."
I had never done, obviously, a movie. I had only just done a little bit of TV. So my manager made it very clear that you don't tell them that you've never done a movie. So I went in and I got the job, started to do, I played an evil monkey licks your bleeding wounds face type of villain in this movie. And I was so green. We would start a scene where I had to open the door, and literally the guy would start to knock and I'd open the door. And he said, "No, a human being would wait until they finish knocking." I go, "Oh, yes, yes, of course." But that was my first film job. Monkey Shines, George Romero. Strange movie. The first time that I even heard about news radio was a straight audition for Paul Simms, who created news radio, and Jimmy Burrows, who directed the pilot. And I came in too young for the role because Paul wanted somebody in their mid-50s or late 50s. I think I was maybe 42, something like that. But I brought in a little bent version of what they had. He didn't quite know whether he was an idiot or an idiot savant. And I brought that to him.
"Okay, that's enough. I have decided to run for president of the United States."
"No."
Then he wrote more of that for the audition for the network. And Jimmy Burrows directed me more in, "You're nuts, but nobody knows if you're really nuts or you're really brilliant." And that's how that character came about. And we just kept writing for that throughout the whole first season of News Radio. First time I did voice work was really something that came out of News Radio, because I was doing News Radio and lots of Southern parts. And Mike Judge knew I had done a lot of Southern stuff and asked me to audition for his King of the Hill show. And I hadn't really done any significant voiceover before that or any cartoon or animation stuff. And he came and had me audition. I auditioned for Dale, wasn't right for that. And I said, who else you got? And they said, well, we have this kind of dumb army barber named Bill. And I said, oh, that's me. William Fontaine de la Tour d'Autrive.
I don't know. My daddy spanked me every day from when I was 9 till I was 16, and I turned out okay. Bastard.
And Hank's boss at Strickland Propane.
You listen to me, God dang it. It's the God dang height of the season. There's no drivers from here to God dang city. You're fired!
So that gig lasted 13 years. First time I ever wore a Speedo for a role was in Justified, when I played a judge. And he was a judge that didn't wear anything under his robe except a Speedo and a gun. We never got to show the Speedo often. But Timothy Oliphant would always say, you're wearing the Speedo today. And I would go, yeah, they always put it in my trailer. Whether you'll never see it, but I'm always wearing it whenever I'm in that show. I think I recurred on that show. It was a great show, Justified. I think it's still in reruns somewhere. But Timmy would always come up and ask me, you're wearing the Speedo. Yes, Tim, I'm wearing it. The first time I worked with the Coen brothers was when Oh Brother came about. It was a straight audition for that role. I came in, Joel and Ethan were sitting at a desk about, 2 feet away. And they said, what, you want to try this guy? And I said, yeah, no, I have something for him. And I took off my glasses and I went, and then I started going. And they both jumped back about a foot. I said, what are you doing? I said, well, he's a blind guy. It's going to be weird.
No, I'm looking for some old-timey material. You see, people can't seem to get enough of it. Since we started broadcasting it on the Pappy Old Daniel Flower Hour, so thank you for stopping by.
Sir.
Matthew Rhys loves to steal a go-kart, a golf cart, and just breakneck race it to the set. Matthew will eschew any any driving. He will take the cart, he will fill it up mostly with people who will be scared, and then he will drive as fast as he can all over the lot and then eventually get to set. But it's some of the funnest things we've done. He's great. We've bonded enough that I can tell him to fuck off.